Now is the time for true worshiping. Amen? And again, we saw this just a little while ago in chapter 4 of John, verse 23. But let me tell you a little bit about what worshipers do that are not true. Y'all hear that?
It's not true.
Let me tell you what worshipers do that are not true.
Okay.
Because obviously God is saying he's seeking those true worshipers. Anybody here is a true worshiper?
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. I hope we all are true worshipers. Amen. And if not, you'll understand a little bit more by the time we get done about what true worshiping is. But let me tell you a little bit about what worshipers do that are not true.
Amen.
Number one. A worshiper who is not a true worshiper is one who comes to church.
Uh-huh.
Amen?
Amen?
Because they think that's the right thing to do. They come to church because they know that this is part of what Christians are supposed to do. Mm-hmm. So we make our way in the church, amen? And we come in and we feel like we gave God our duty or gave God what was due him because Sunday is supposed to be the Sabbath. Literally, the Sabbath is, but Sunday for Christianity has become the Sabbath. So our Sabbath, we know we're supposed to give God his day.
Uh-huh.
And this is his due. So when we come in here not expecting to hear a powerful word from the Lord that is going to change our lives. I'm talking about those who worship that are not true.
Amen.
You might come in here and you might understand that there's going to be a word preached. You might come in here and you feel that the songs of Zion will be sung and, you know, you get excited and feel good about it. Amen. But you're not really coming in to experience God at a whole nother level. See, this is where we're going, church. This is where PFL is going. We're going to experience God, what do we say? In his Shekinah glory.
Amen.
We're talking about another whole level of God's presence other than where two or three gathered, there he is.
Amen.
See, we know God shows up where two or three are gathered. Wherever that is, in your home, in your car, if two of you all are together and y'all talking about Jesus, because Jesus says, there I am too.
Amen.
That's not the Shekinah glory though. That's his presence just being in the midst.
Okay.
To either give direct the conversation or to give some enlightenment, some revelation, encouragement, you know what I mean? But true worshipers come with a whole nother attitude. Amen? So number one, we said a worshiper who is not true, one, will come to church because they know that's the right thing to do.
Right.
There's a whole lot of people that come to church that'll come in, sit down, get a word, might enjoy the word, talk about, man, that was a mighty word today, and leave out of here and never think about that word, never think about what does that word really mean to me. What was God saying to me that is supposed to talk to me to change me?
Right.
Amen? Amen? Or maybe to encourage me. Maybe the word wasn't supposed to change me. Maybe it was to confirm where I'm supposed to be.
Right.
And the word was like, yes, you're doing great. Keep it up. And he encourages us. So you walk out of here a little bit more faithful. You walk out of here a little bit more empowered. You walk out of here like got a little step, you know, a little jump in the step or what has that word go? A worshiper that is not true will be one who pray openly to impress people.
Right.
They sound good.
Yeah.
Remember in Matthew chapter 5, and Jesus, before he started talking about the Lord's Prayer, he says, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites who pray openly, who want to be heard, who puts on the right clothing and want to be seen. He says they already received their reward because they wanted to be seen. They wanted to be heard. He said, but they're not really, he called them hypocrites. They're not true worshipers. They are worshipers because they know they believe in God. They don't know God, but they believe in God. They have a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. That's what the scripture says. So, a worshiper that's not true will come in and they get the praying, amen? And they get this praying out loud and they do sound good. And you walk out of there thinking, man, I was impressed that woman or that man sure know how to pray. Amen. When I need somebody to pray, I call that sister or brother. Amen. Because you were impressed, but was God impressed? See, that's the one that when you pray, and you don't have to show, you don't have to speak loud. Amen. I'm sorry, I just hit a moment. Because, you know, when you talk about speaking in tongues, openly. Yeah. And the Bible says, do not speak openly out loud unless there's an interpreter there. Uh-huh. Let not many of you speak, and if you do, one at a time. Yeah. Amen? Yeah. Because there's two different types of tongues. Okay. One is a language, and another one, an earthly language, and another one is a heavenly language. Uh-huh. A heavenly language is between you and God. And unless God is going to use you to minister that language, the heavenly language, because he's got something to say to the congregation, he will also give an interpreter. Because who's going to interpret what you said if you're speaking in tongues to the congregation? But how many of us know that there are some folks that will speak in tongues just because they know they got the gift, and they want to be heard, and they want to know that, oh, look at me. That's not a true worshiper. That's one who wants to be impressed or impressed upon somebody else. Amen?
Amen.
A worshiper, the last one, we can go on, but the last one I want to talk about is a worshiper who is not true is one who is a doer, but not walking by faith. That's the one that comes in, even preachers, that come in and serve the Lord. Sing in a choir. Usher. Do all kind of works. Amen? But not accompanied by faith. So they believe that their works is going to impress God. Their works is going to have God receive what they're doing, because I am working in the church. I am ministering from the pulpit. Amen? What did Jesus say about those who was casting out demons again? And he says, Lord, he says, why do you call me Lord? Right? One thing he says is, have we not cast out demons in your name? And he says, depart from me. I never knew you. But yet they did the work of the Lord. Demons were cast out in the name of Jesus. Which tells me that God can use anybody, unbelievers as well as believers, to do his work. But again, are they true worshipers? Or were they impressed because they were doing the work of God, but not, again, by faith, through the relationship of God. Amen?
Amen?
See, you can serve God, you can worship God that way, but it's gotta be true.
Right.
It's gotta be through a relationship that you have with Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
And when you do it that way, if you have a relationship with Jesus, then know that it is gonna be by faith. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
Turn with me to Exodus chapter 20. This is the Ten Commandments. Amen? See, because there's many ways that we can worship God. Amen?
Amen.
And in the Old Testament, I'm not even going to give you, I was looking at all these Hebrew words and all these Greek words, talking about the translations of the word worship.
Yeah.
Amen? We're going to look at the words, we're going to look at the translations, but I am not about to give you all the different Hebrew words that I ran across, as well as the Greek words, because there's many.
Wow.
Some of them I had a little hard time pronouncing, amen? But I don't think that's as much as important as what the translation means. Amen? So, in Exodus, let's look at Exodus chapter 20, amen? You all know this is the Ten Commandments, right? And one of the things I want you to know when we're looking at what worship is, the first thing we need to understand is that God commands worship. It's in his commandment. Let's start in verse 1 and read through verse 5. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor what? Serve them.
Right.
Serve them is another translation of worship them, right?
Okay.
He says, for I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but, we might as well finish reading this, but showing mercy to thousands to those who love me and keep my commandments. He says, listen, there's but one God, me. He says, I am the only one that you shall bow down to. I am the only one that you shall serve.
Yes.
I am the only one that you shall worship.
Amen.
I am the only one that you shall give praise to.
Yes.
I am the only one that shall operate by faith.
Yes.
I am the only God that exists.
Yes.
And if you start to bow down or serve or worship anything outside of me,
yes,
we got a problem.
Amen. Wow. Yeah.
But the Old Testament translation, again, the word, I was going to give you the Greek word, the Hebrew word, but it means to bow down. That's what in the Old Testament is too. One of them is to bow down, to prostrate oneself out of reverence. Amen? And the other one is, just what we read, to serve. So we see in the Old Testament that we see that there's two things that God loves. One, he desires our worship, and here he desires our attitude of bowing.
Mm.
You know, remember even with Moses when he met him in the burning bush, he said, take off your sandals, for the place where you stand is holy ground.
Yeah.
And so wherever God is, when God shows up, here we go, Shekinah glory. See, we haven't experienced it yet. That's why we're not on our faces
wow.
yet.
Wow. Yeah.
Remember when we talked about that years ago?
Wait, yeah.
Years ago. I don't know what God is about to do, but remember
wow.
it was years ago I said,
yeah.
one day, God is going to have us on our faces.
Yep.
I said, I don't know when, I don't know how.
Yep.
But one day, but now it's interesting that now is
wow.
the time. The time is coming, remember in John? The time is coming and now is.
Wow, amen.
That the true worshipers
yeah.
are now going to step forward.
Yes.
And so again, wait until that Shekinah glory comes in.
My Lord.
Remember we talked about we need to start praying for that.
Yeah.
We need to, as every, we said, you all, some of y'all weren't here last week, but we said that we asked everybody here last week, starting last week, to start praying continuously. Have a Lord, have a way or have a often that the Lord put it on your heart to start praying for the Shekinah glory of God to come in. Because when that happens, it's going to change everything. The atmosphere is going to be a lot different. You will become a lot different. I will become a lot different. Amen?
Amen.
Because when God comes in, and remember we talked about God seekers,
yes.
which we're going to pick up later. But when God came in that book, the God seekers, nobody expected him to come in the way he came
wow.
in.
Yes.
But when he came in, every heart was changed and everybody was on their face. And I'm trying to tell us now that that's where we want to be. Because what happens is we're forced then to be on our face. See, right now, God would love for us to willingly get up when we recognize just his presence is in the place. When we start worshiping and we have that worshiping experience even in the beginning of the service, when we're doing our praise and our worship, he would love for some of us. Actually, all of us, but he would love for some of us to get down on our face when we feel his presence from worship.
Amen.
When the song is being played
yes.
and you feel the Lord is right there and he's ministering to you right then and there. And I'm not the only one. I'm sure there's some of y'all that feel that God is saying, bow down.
Yeah. Yeah.
But he's not going to force you to bow down. But he expects us to bow down.
Yeah, yeah.
But
thank you, Lord.
When the Shekinah glory comes in,
yeah.
you ain't going to have you're felt moved to do so and don't know why.
My God.
You won't even realize that it's God pushing you to the fore.
Yeah.
Because that's what happened in the God seekers. When they all prayed, God, we want you to come in.
Yeah.
We need you to come in. God desires us to worship him like that. Look at your program.
Yeah.
You see it?
Wow. Yeah.
That's how they used to do it. Back in the day, when God was showing up, whether it was the pillar of fire by day or the cloud, the pillar of in that manifestation, they would fall on their faces.
Wow.
Can you imagine back then, during that time that you see that program and that picture there, when they're all on their faces, can you imagine back then when there were some folks that were, they stole something, an idol, and God got upset, and he began to send a plague among the people of Israel, and it was only until Moses went up and interceded, and then told Aaron, grab the serpent staff, and go down and stand between the people that have already died and the ones that have yet to die because of the plague. And everybody that looked at the serpent would then be healed because there was a plague. And some of them had already died though. And God told Moses to take that staff and go down there, and whoever looked at the serpent on the staff would be healed. And that's what happened. But can you imagine those that actually got delivered after seeing all their other brethren fall before them? What do you think they did? They probably fell on their faces and prostrated before the Lord and said, Lord, thank you for saving me. You see what I'm saying? When you gave your life to Christ and you humbled yourself before the Lord, y'all remember that day? How important that day it was when it was genuine and true. You know, the Bible talks about true righteousness and genuine faith. He put these adjectives on the front. Amen. Excuse me, open that up. Amen. And so one of the things that we're talking about is what God is showing us here is that, listen, not only is this a command, but I desire this. And you should willingly want to do this. Amen.
Amen.
Turn with me to Philippians. Because those were the translations in the Old Testament, right? To bow down, to prostrate oneself, to serve. Amen? So we carry those same attributes of how to worship from the Old Testament. We bring them on over into the New Testament. Amen? But here's what Jesus did a little differently that Paul writes about in Philippians chapter 3. We'll pick up in verse 1. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Philippians chapter 3, verse 1 says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same things to you is not tedious, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of mutilation. For, listen to this, we are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit. What did John say? John said, the Father is seeking true worshipers that worship him in what? In spirit and in truth.
Yeah.
Because God is spirit, right?
Yeah.
Paul says here, we are the circumcision who worship God in spirit.
Yeah.
Circumcision then means for us, because circumcision back then, remember, identifies those who were God's.
Okay.
I mean, not God's, those who were God's people.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Those who belong to the Lord. If you were circumcised, that means you were a Hebrew, and salvation is of the Jews, amen? And so back then, remember, everything was by the law, so you had to be circumcised. You had to bow down. You had to prostrate yourself. You had to serve the Lord physically, amen? But see, you come over here in the New Testament, you take all of that, and now Jesus turns around and says, I want you to do the same things. But now, instead of you physically have to circumcise yourself, I identify you by the blood of Jesus. I identify you being mine because now you gave your life to Christ. So now, the same thing that we worshiped back then physically, now we can worship by heart. Now God looks at the heart. Remember even when he was talking about those who try to help the Ten Commandments, and he turned around and he says, but but I know if you know you didn't actually commit adultery. I know you didn't actually commit murder, but if in your heart you lusted after that woman, you already committed adultery.
Yeah.
He said it's about the heart now. It's about the circumcision in the heart. Have you now had that transference from the law to faith where now is about faith. So now when you worship, your true worshiping becomes an attitude of heart. Now I'm going to worship God in spirit because I have the spirit. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to go to John. This is where our text takes us. Amen?
Amen.
John chapter 4. Now, in John, just so you know, this story starts with this Samaritan woman. Amen. That's why I say, as I believe at the, in the heading, the Samaritan woman meets her Messiah.
Yeah.
Meets her Messiah.
Her Messiah.
Amen.
Amen.
Just so you know, she didn't know that was her Messiah.
Amen.
That's why she didn't recognize Jesus. That's why Jesus says in verse 10, Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who asked you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. So the conversation is because Jesus now has been traveling, he's been ministering, he's weary, but all his disciples are not with him. So he comes to Jacob's well, and he's sitting there by the well, wearied. And this woman comes along, Samaritan, and she wants to draw some water. So Jesus, being thirsty, says, would you give me a drink? And the Samaritan woman says, you're a Jew. How is it you being a Jew ask a Samaritan for a drink? Jesus looked at her and said, wait a minute. If you knew the gift of God, if you knew who it is that is asking this question, obviously you don't know who I am.
Hello.
Right. You don't see the hat, do you? Obviously you don't realize that I am that I am. Obviously you don't realize that the water that I'm asking you is not the same water that if you ask me, that I would give you, and the water that I give you, you will never thirst again. The water that I give you will spring up as living water, and you will be always on fire and always satisfied, because the water that I give you is of the Holy Spirit. But you don't know that right now, because all you know is Jews don't have no dealings with Samaritans. And so the conversation is all about, you know, drinking and water and all of that, right? But then she changes the conversation.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Jesus didn't change it.
Right.
If you look down, and let's just pick up in verse 13. Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. The woman answered, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you have well said, I have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke well, or you spoke truly. They still talking, you know, Jesus is trying to show her that look.
I know.
You don't recognize me yet. Okay, let me show you something that you don't know that I know. And once I share with you something that you know that is really going on, like the woman, the husband that you are with right now, is not even your husband. You're committing adultery.
Woo.
It's somebody else's husband.
Wow.
Now you did have five husbands. I don't know what happened to them five husbands, but the one that you have right now is not yours. There's a husband, but it's not yours.
Wow.
And she says, the woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. So now he's starting to make a little headway. Now he done got her, now to move him from just a Jew to this man must be a prophet. Because he knows some stuff here. But then she goes on, who brings up worship? Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. See, if you keep talking to Jesus long enough, he'll get them to the whole crux of the matter, the whole reason why you are here. I know you had this thing against Jerusalem, you know, Jews and Samaritans, but really, what is it that's really going on?
Right.
You know, he always has a way of just pushing right to the heart of the matter.
Yeah.
And so she comes up with, our fathers worship on this mountain. Like, basically, this is ours. mountain that you are standing on, Jesus, belongs to us, the Samaritans. Uh-huh. Our fathers worship on this mountain. Uh-huh. You Jews worship in Jerusalem, right? And Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father." Amen?
Amen.
Now, here's the thing that the Lord showed me. I was like, oh, I didn't know that. The reason that she said that they worship on that mountain is because Samaritans, in the Samaritan Bible, is only 5 books, the Pentateuchs. I got this out of the Helly's Commentary and the NIV Study Bible. But the Samaritan's Bible, they only have the Pentateuchs. So they only know as far as what Moses wrote.
Wow.
So they know about Jacob's well. They know about Moses. And by the way, Moses, Jacob, and Abraham, Isaac and Abraham, built an altar on this mountain. See, they know that. So they decide, well, if that's our history, if that's, you know, our genealogy and the place where we're going to actually continue on in the work of the Lord and worship God, then let us build a place of worship on this mountain. Amen? Makes sense, don't it? So the Samaritans believe that this is their mountain and this is where they are. Guess what the Jews did? Once they built that place of worship, the Jews tore it down. So now you know why the Jews and the Samaritans don't have any dealings. They have issues with one another because here it is, you all worship in Jerusalem, leave us alone. We worshiping over here. Why are you going to tear our stuff down? You know why? Because there's but one God.
Amen.
And you're not going to say that the Messiah is your God and then expect us to accept that when we know the Messiah is our God.
Amen.
See, the Messiah is the God of all the peoples who believe in Jesus. There is neither slave nor free, Jew nor Gentile, but whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But back then, they had to draw lines. The Jews, this is ours. So what did they do? They built a temple in Jerusalem. But they wouldn't leave the Samaritans and let them build a temple that they could worship, even though it's the same God. Because guess what? That's what the devil will do. He will always cause division. And I'm telling you now, if you're going to, I shared this with Lady Elect today, if you're going to go to another level of worship, intimacy, see, you can't get close to God like this and not change. You can't get closer to God in the way we're planning to get closer to God and not have it affect you in a way where it will change you so that God use you at another whole level. That's what God wants to do. He wants us, in the day we're living in, with all the crazy stuff going on, the times are changing. I mean, every time I turn around, there's another hurricane, another earthquake. I mean, it's like one disaster after another. You got the shooting going on. I mean, it's like there's just so much going on. At what point is God coming back? And when he comes back, where will we be? Will we be worshiping God, or will we be truly worshiping the Lord?
Amen. Amen.
I want to be a true worshiper.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Verse 22 says it this way: you worship what you do not know. We worship. I mean, excuse me. I always say that always wrong. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. And what Jesus was saying to this woman is that salvation is going to come through the Jewish genealogy. That's why she didn't recognize Jesus as the Messiah. She didn't expect the Messiah to be a Jew, because Jew and Samaritans have no dealings with one another. So here you are coming up to me, and the first thing I see is Jew. And I don't have the knowledge, because all I know is the 5 books. I don't have Isaiah. You know, talking about, you know, for unto us a child is born and a son is given. You know what I mean? We don't have all the other scriptures that shows us that he's going to be hanging on a cross and he's going to come lowly and riding on a... She don't have all of that.
Right.
all she has is where he's coming out of, and that it's going to be, or the place where they worship is going to be because of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Moses, because Moses built the altar there as well. But Jesus, like I said, has a way of getting to the heart of the matter. Amen.
Amen.
One of the things I want to share with you, turn with me to that was John chapter 16. And we're going to close right here and pick up next week. Amen. John chapter 16. And we're going to pick up in verse, I want to say 7. No, let's pick up, let's start at verse 5 where it says the work of the Holy Spirit. But now Jesus says, I go away to him who sent me. And none of you ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. The Helper being the Holy Spirit. Amen?
Amen.
In John chapter 14, verse 23, he says, if you love me, you'll obey me. And we, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, all in three in one, will come to you and make our home in you.
Amen?
Amen. So he says, and I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. Now, verse 12. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, let me say that again. When he, the Spirit of truth, comes, right? He will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you of things to come. Now keep this in mind as we go back to John chapter 4. Verse 13, when he, the Spirit of truth, amen, has come, he will guide you into all what? Truth, right? And he will not speak on his own authority, but he will guide you in all truth. The Spirit of what? Truth, amen? If you go back to John chapter 4, it says, but the hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The reason that the Samaritan was having such a hard time, she was trying to worship God without truth. She only knew but so much. She hadn't got the revelation of Jesus, of who he is, in the spiritual side. But God is spirit. So you have to have the Spirit of God in order for you to recognize the Spirit of God. Y'all hear that? You have to have the Spirit of God in order to recognize the Spirit of God. So if you're going to worship God in spirit, you have to have the Spirit of truth so that he will guide you, so that you don't get out here and start worshiping something that is not of God. See, because there's a whole lot of spirits out here that will begin to try to imitate who God is. Amen? See, how many know that the devil or the demons try to disguise themselves to what? To be angels of light. Why? So that they can deceive the folks that are trying to worship God.
Right.
But if I can get you to take your eyes off God, believing that you are worshiping God, thinking you're still worshiping God, and have you all out there, then you're going to be outside of what God is saying. And unless you have the Spirit of God in you, you hear what I'm saying?
Amen.
Unless you got the Spirit of God in you, you can't worship God truly. You can't worship God and be a true worshiper.
Amen.
So what I want us to know and leave here before we come back to part two of this, because we're going to be back here again. Amen? And we're going to talk about truth. And we're going to talk about the Spirit. Amen? And how with the two coming together. Amen? Because even Jesus says, what? That you have to, my words, they are what? Spirit and life. Amen? Not words, truth. Words, truth, are spirit and they are life. You can't have life without the Spirit and the Word of God. But you put the two together, and that's how you know it's of God, see? You don't know, we're going to pick and talk about that later, but that's how you know when you're walking in the will of God. Everything you do, when you're not sure about it, should have not only a good feeling that the Lord is telling me and moving me. I feel, you know, I feel the unction, what do you call it, the unction of the Holy Spirit trying to move me this way or tell me to do this or have me to say that. But if there's no word to confirm that, that's not God. Because God will never, He will never send His Spirit out there without His Word.
Amen. Wow.
I'm going to say this before I close. It just came to me. That's why I hesitate. Jesus, when He was in the wilderness, why was He effective and Satan wasn't? Remember? Satan said to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, cast yourself off this mountain. Didn't that God say, He used God's Word. Didn't that God say He would give your angels charge over you, lest you dash your feet against the stone? He spoke God's word.
Right.
So why didn't Jesus say, you know what, you're right, that is the word of God, let me do it. Why? Because Satan didn't have the spirit. He had the word, but he has no spirit of God in him. Jesus turned around and said what? He said, thou shalt worship the Lord and him only shall I serve.
Amen.
But he said the word of God, but he also has what?
The Spirit.
The Spirit. He is God in the Spirit and in the flesh. Amen?
Amen.
Now is the time. Now is the time for true worshiping. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That's where we're going to.